So I'm here with John Ashton, who you're part of WriteArm, well, you founded WriteArm, which is an organisation we're going to be talking about, but also the Kitchen Community Table.
KitchenTable Community.
KitchenTable Community. Yeah. So we'll start off with WriteArm, John, because I know you've got a background in journalism, so we're just having a good chat offstage about future of journalism and future of content and how people buy in content nowadays. So maybe start off a bit about your background and then we'll talk about your new initiative.
Yeah, well, I had a background in journalism, primarily in TV, current affairs, moved into writing books and articles, and realised after a few years that there wasn't much future in it. I mean, you could see the traditional media being eroded. To cut a long story short, and via a very circuitous journey, I set up WriteArm, which is a content and copywriting agency, which is commercial. I mean, we work primarily for people in the marketing industry in one area or the other. One of the interesting things about it is a lot of the people who work for us, and all our writers are freelance, is that they have a background in journalism, and they work both sides of the fence. You know, they do commercial work and they still do traditional journalism, often for the trade press. So it's kind of, you know, it signifies the way, the fact that our company's been successful and that, you know, my previous career in journalism was going down the drain, signifies the way that journalism is going. You know, it's becoming a lot more commercial, which is in some ways to its detriment, but at least it's keeping it alive.
And that's like paid for articles, is it, as you're talking about? That's just one feature, isn't it, of...
Yeah, well,
the way it's been commercialised.
Well, yeah, I mean, our clients pay for editorial content. You know, they want to establish their authority in a particular field, so they'll pay for an article which does that. You know, they might put it on LinkedIn, they might put it on their blog, they might try and get it in the trade press, but it shows that they've got authority. They might not have time to write it, but it shows their expertise, you know, and through that they gain credibility, and through their credibility, you know, they hopefully gain clients.
Yeah. So are you saying like journalism is not quite dead yet, is it? It's kind of staggering on a bit, but people are just adapting, aren't they? And the difficulty is, I guess, with journalism is that you can't really make money out of it. It's difficult to make money out of
it. It is difficult to make
money. There's so much free content.
Yeah, that's right. And there's so many providers, so many outlets that are fighting to survive. They cut their budget, so they can't afford to pay people very much. I mean, there are other models. You know, there's the Patreon model where you write, and if you get an audience, then you can get them to fund you. That's very successful. Some people, and then at the top end, there's still the part of Fleet Street at least is still reasonably well funded, but it's nothing like it was 20 years ago.
Yeah, and that's a problem, isn't it, for democracy? Because obviously, we kind of need a strong media, an independent media, to hold people to account. And people often talk about state intervention in the media, but obviously that wouldn't jeopardise their independence. So it's difficult, isn't it? And we're basically relying on the BBC a lot of the time.
A lot of the time we are. It's a huge problem, particularly at a local level, because local journalism has been eviscerated. So, you know, for example, reporting on what local councils do, reporting on courts, a lot of that has gone. I mean, I just, before I arrived, I had an email from someone who's got a local council scandal, a planning scandal. I don't know which council it is, but, you know, this is, on the face of it, a really important and big story, but it's completely gone under the media radar.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, an indicator of where particularly the local media, local journalism has gone.
Yeah. So a bit more about your new initiative then. Tell us all about that, because it's on the back of, and I know this wasn't intentional, but it's on the back of a lot of people kind of losing their job and finding themselves in a space where, you know, they're not on a PAYE salary anymore. And
that's right. Yeah, it's called the Kitchen Table Community. Yeah. I've actually been working on it for 3 years. It just so happened to launch during a time when everybody's working from their kitchen table. And it really builds on my experience of starting an agency from scratch with no clue how to do it. I mean, my background's in journalism. I suppose I'm broadly speaking a creative, and creatives tend not to have much business sense. So I set up this agency from my kitchen table with no sense of how to do it, just an idea. And I did what I call the kitchen table method, which is you don't have the premises, but you don't have staff. You use freelancers. You're loyal to your freelancer. You have a good body of talent who is at your disposal. Who you pay properly. You don't treat them like a Victorian mill owner might treat their staff, you know. So you, it's a very kind of forward-facing model, I think, particularly at the moment, because there are so many people who are at home wondering what the next step is. And, you know, my view is that if you are a creative, if you're in the commercial creative industries, and I don't just mean by that copywriting, which is what my agency does, I mean things like design, web development, marketing, events, video production, animation, all those kind of professions that fall within the commercial creative industries. I'm saying to those people, whether they're currently freelance or furloughed or maybe still have a staff job, if you ever thought of doing an agency, now's the time to do it. And really, you don't need much business sense, because I didn't have that. You know, one of my mantras in this is, you know, if this idiot can do it, then so can you. So there's a lot of, in the community is to support those people. It's for them to support each other. It's a marketplace where they can trade services. And there's a lot of educational content for those who need it, for those who are at the start of that journey. Because it's also for people who have already set up an agency. But for those who haven't, then, you know, there's a book I wrote, there's an online course and so on. So they can learn the basics before they set up.
Yeah, it's quite daunting, isn't it, starting up a business, because you're taking on more risk and you're thinking of hiring people. There's a whole load of bureaucracy that goes with that, but also there's not the comfort of knowing that, you know, your kind of paymaster, as it were, is you're detached from it and you're not like doing the accounts and the finances, that someone else is doing that. And now you're doing it yourself.
It is a bit daunting, but I mean, in fact, if you do it on using the kitchen table method, you know, you haven't got the overheads of offices and staff. You learn on the job. There's a bit of extra admin and so on, but I didn't take on any debt to do it. And I wouldn't advocate people taking on loans unless they really need it. But my view is it's actually a safer bet than being freelance. Because if you're freelance, you tend to just have a few clients. If you're a staffer, you've got one client. You've got, you know, the company you work for. You're actually quite vulnerable. If you have an agency, then you can take on many more clients. And actually, you know, I've found that any kind of dips you can ride out, and I think we'll be able to ride out the coming recession, partly because we've got low overheads, we're actually pretty price competitive.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's not a race to the bottom on price. We're not, you know, I wouldn't advocate going rock bottom, and certainly my agency doesn't. And we pay properly, and I would always advocate that. But if you're competing with an agency that's got a lot of staff, bricks and mortar, then their clients are paying for that, you know, so they charge a lot higher. So you can still charge well and pay well.
People are going to want to work from home.
That's right.
So isn't it kind of, it fits into how the future might look like.
You know, one of my big points when I say to people, set up on your own, work from home, is that when you work flexibly in that way and employ people who do the same, then actually you're less stressed, you're happier, and happier people do better work. You know, it's a cliche, but it's actually a win-win.
Yeah.
And if you have those people working for you who, you know, you're loyal to, they're able to shape their working life around their personal needs and family commitments. You know, they do better work, you know, and there's no point in forcing somebody to do a 9-to-5 if it doesn't work for them.
Yeah.
You're not going to get as good work out of them, and they're not going to be as fulfilled.
So just tell us a bit more about, before we go into the second half, about your organisation. How can we find out more about the new initiative?
Well, if kitchentable.community is the website, there you'll find links to the book and the course and so on. It's currently free. I mean, it's going to be a subscription service ultimately, but it's currently free. The book you find on Amazon and elsewhere. It's called The Kitchen Table Method.
Yeah.
And we've got quite a few things on YouTube as well.
Yeah.
And podcasts. We've got a podcast.
Okay.
Called The Kitchen Table Community Podcast.
So what is The Kitchen Table Method we're going to in detail in the second half, but what is this a kind of a one-size-fits-all approach to
Yeah, it sets out the bare bones, you know, so it says... it advocates obviously home working and using a network of freelancers, but it sets out the bare bones in terms of thinking about company culture, because I think that's very important. There's a section on cash and how to manage your cash and the basics of finance. There's something that sets out the ground rules of working with freelancers and treating them well. And there's something about basically how you market yourself, how you develop a commercial proposition. So there's kind of four pillars, four legs to the table.
Yeah. Because there's a lot of, the market's quite big for this, as you say, but there's a lot of freelancers now, isn't there? So there's kind of a lot of people going for certain types of work. Is that right or not?
Well, there are a lot of freelancers out there who, you know, they have, some of them are effectively staffers because they have one main client. And then there are others who, you know, maybe have a handful of clients. And then there are those who've kind of taken the next step on and have essentially got an agency because they have more work than they can handle and they farm it out to their friends. And often those people don't consider themselves to be agencies, but in fact they are. One of the things I'm saying is, you know, if you run that model already, you are an agency, so think like one.
Yeah.
And formalise it a bit more.
Yeah. Okay, we'll leave it there for now. Second half, we're going to be talking a lot more to John about his organisation and about the future of journalism.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
So I'm back here with John Ashton, who's a journalist, but also you're the founder of Right Arm and also the Kitchen Table Method.
The Kitchen Table Community
yeah. And the method that goes with that.
Yeah.
So should we just talk a bit more about that method then? And we were just talking a bit off stage about how it can be a bit precarious being a freelancer. It's not all milk and honey, is it? It can be difficult. It works for some people, but for others, you kind of have to have a certain mindset, which I think your method looks into in detail to be a freelancer, don't you, in a way? And you kind of have to have more than one client, which I know you referred to in the first half.
Yeah, well, I mean,
kind of build a bit of safety net.
Yeah, I mean, my view is that there are massive benefits to being a freelancer. I'm not an advocate of the gig economy, low-paid gig economy at all. I think that if you're going to get the best out of people, you've got to pay them properly. And, you know, the agency model that I advocate of employing freelancers, you know, you make a margin on the freelancers' work, but you don't screw them to the ground on cost because you need the loyalty of those people. And morally, you should be paying them properly. And, you know, what I always say is I try to get people their ideal rate. And if we can't get them their ideal rate, then we'll get them one they're happy with. And if, you know, if you really have to ask them, because the client hasn't got a great budget, if you have to ask them to go lower than they're comfortable with, then you make it up for them on the next job.
Yeah,
I think that if you're going to build a sustainable agency, you need to behave like that. You need to have a company culture that puts fairness absolutely at the centre. You've got to be fair to people. You've got to be fair to your clients. You know, don't rip them off. Don't rip anybody off. You know, work responsibly.
Yeah. Do you think this is people are going to be doing that, bigger agencies? I mean, I'm guessing you're working with advertising agencies and news outlets.
Not news outlets. We work in pretty much entirely in the marketing.
In the marketing.
Yeah.
So they're not. Do they put off hiring their own people then, and they just farm out some of their work to people such as yourselves?
Is they do sometimes do that. But I think a lot of these agencies are set up. They throw what's called overflow work at us. So they, you know, when their people can no longer cope. But you know, they're generally loyal to their own staff. I think obviously things will change with the coming recession, but what tends to happen with the bigger agencies, advertising agencies and so on, is when they lay people off, they then hire them back in as freelancers.
Yeah.
So they tend to be quite fair-minded because they know if they go down on price, then the quality will suffer.
Yeah. What about in terms of keeping a client happy then? What's the key to keeping clients happy, particularly if you're a freelancer? Is there certain tricks of the trade? You can over-service, because I've been in consultancy before, and political consultancy, and it's kind of over-servicing is a big issue, isn't it? Because obviously you're giving more, but you're not getting paid more. So it's always a delicate balance.
Yeah, well, I'm a great advocate of being good to work with, and that's producing good work is part of that, but it's not the whole of it. I say that you should treat clients as you treat friends. That's not because they are friends, but because you know they're human and they need to You know, in their everyday life, they need it to be as bright as possible. And if you make their life bright, then they will like working with you. It's very simple, a very simple equation.
Yeah.
You know, there's a cliche in marketing that people buy from people. But I just think if you respect the fact that they're human with human challenges and deserve to be treated with respect, think of yourself as dealing with people rather than with companies, then you're sort of halfway there, really.
Yeah, we spoke in the first half about journalism, and where do you see the future of journalism going? I mean, people said wrote off newspapers, at least a hard copy form newspapers a long time ago, didn't they? And obviously, any shop, you've still got, you know, we've still got like 8 to 10 national titles, haven't we?
Yeah.
Producing something every day, which, you know, 20 years ago, people said wouldn't happen. So
yeah, well, it's been salami sliced, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, it's gradually being eroded, you know. Most of the papers laying people off, BBC's laying people off, you know, that's happening. I mean, to some extent, you know, the technological advances make newsrooms more productive, but the fact is, you know, it's pretty grim in a lot of areas of journalism, and where it's going to go is difficult to predict. I mean, you know, you do have these platforms like Patreon, as I said, which, you know, where good journalists can get backing, but it's not sad to say, it's not a career I'd advocate for a young person now. You know, if they wanted, you know, if they really had fire in the belly and wanted to do it, I'd say yes, sure. But if you want to create a, you know, a sustainable future for yourself, you want to, you know, be able to, you know, afford the basics in life, then it's not a great place to be, unless you really rise to the top, unless you're an absolute star, you know. But what journalism tends to do is sucks in young people and spits out bitter middle-aged people, you know.
Yeah. I mean, investigatory journalism, we're talking about the Sunday Times. I mean, it's very few newspapers or very few organisations which had the resources to do proper investigations.
That's right.
And that's a problem in itself, isn't it? Particularly when we get big stories, you know, like the coronavirus pandemic, when you kind of need maybe to go across borders as well.
Yeah. I mean,
and that is a problem.
Investigative journalism's a really interesting one. I mean, it's expensive, and that's why it's been diminished. But on the other side, you've got this, you've got massive availability of data. Well, I mean, when I started, the problem was you couldn't get hold of anything. There was no Freedom of Information Act. You know, we didn't live in the era of big data. Just, you know, to find out one, you know, unearth one little fact for your program, you know, you could spend 3 or 4 days on the phone. Or you have to go to a library and so on. Now it's at your fingertips of the net. So it's, you know, it's kind of cheaper to produce than it was, but it's still expensive.
Yeah.
And it's got a market, but it's not a huge market. I mean, I tended to work in current affairs documentaries, and the problem with them, they're expensive and nobody watched them, you know, sadly.
Yeah.
So you could make some trash reality TV and a lot of people would watch it, and it wasn't that expensive. But, you know, to spend 3 months on the road working on a story, it's pricey, and it's, you know, 2 or 3 times the price if you have to do an international investigation.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, what where does that leave democracy then? Because obviously it means that people can get away with more, particularly at a local level, you know, local democracy, local councils.
Yeah.
You know, it's leaving a door open, isn't it?
Well, really, I see it as much a distribution issue, because uncovering information in a way has never been easier, but finding an audience for that through, you know, through the right distributive channel, like a, you know, a big newspaper or TV, is ever more difficult because they won't pay for it.
Yeah. So just before we go then, how can we get find out more information about, first of all, Right Arm, and how can people get involved in that? And also the Kitchen Community.
Okay. Well, Right Arm is
project.
Right as in writing. So it's writearm.co.uk. And the Kitchen Table Community is at kitchentable.community.
Yeah, it's open. Anyone can join that. Do you have to have that mindset of joining an agency, or just can you be a freelancer?
I think it will attract those people who want to have an agency. But many of those are currently freelancers, and they want to dip the toe in the water, find out more about it. I mean, we've got quite a few members who are, you know, are in that place where they've thought, oh, maybe I would like an agency. Let's look into this more. Most of them are pretty determined that they're going to do it, and quite a lot of them already have it. But it, you know, it's for the curious as well.
Yeah, it's going to be a growing trend, isn't it? So you're only going to get more, these organisations are only going to get more popular in the future, probably, and maybe we're saying goodbye to like the office, kind of the big offices and the big organised people going into big offices and commuting. That's one of the big changes we're going to see, isn't it?
It is, and it's a change for the better, I believe, because, you know, for many people, the commute is toxic. You know, I mean, it's stressful. Working in an office is stressful. I mean, yeah, the office is the last place you're going to have creative ideas, right? And if you're working in the creative industries, that's an exaggeration because people do bounce off each other, and you can get these very creative scrums in offices. But you know, if you're sitting at your computer, project managing something or whatever, then I know it now, you know, because those days when I'm sitting at my computer rather than sort of, you know, out and about, I have my best ideas in the shower and when I'm walking, you know. But the flexible lifestyle gives me that ability to get out of the house and to do things that spark creative ideas. And I think, you know, business across the board will recognise that and is slowly recognising that, you know, people are more creative and more productive when they're away from the office, when they're liberated, you know.
Yeah, brilliant. We'll leave it there. John, thanks for coming in. All the best for that.
Pleasure, thank you.
Cheers.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.